So today I want to talk about DNA-dependent RNA synthesis. This lecture should actually have been before the DNA replication lecture. If you go through the replicative cycle strictly according to what happens, this should be first, right? Does anyone disagree with that? It's a stupid question. Why do you think this should be before DNA replication?
Because RNA is better.
There's a better answer.
RNA before
DNA. What?
RNA came before DNA.
Well, I like both of those answers, but they're not what I'm looking for. Yes? Exactly. All DNA virus genomes have to make at least one protein before they replicate. So in order to make a protein, you have to make an mRNA. And to do that, you have to do what we're going to talk about today. So next year, when we have four exams, I'm going to put this lecture in front of the other one because it makes more sense. So today we're going to be talking about DNA genomes getting into the cell and immediately being transcribed and the implications that has for the life cycles. So DNA-dependent RNA synthesis, you have what kind of DNA template do you need to be made into RNA? Is single-stranded good?
No.
Is gapped double-stranded good? No. Okay, you need it to be double-stranded. And this happens all along the DNA all at once. This is a famous picture of an electron micrograph of transcribing DNA molecules. And here's the beginning of the DNA, here's the end, the 5' end and the 3' end. Well, they're double-stranded, so that's meaningless. This is where transcription would begin. And you can see there are many molecules of RNA being made all along the length. So there are many polymerases going down at the same time on this molecule, making lots and lots of RNA. So this is the process we're going to be talking about today. It only happens with DNA viruses. These enzymes that we'll talk about only work, I shouldn't say only, because it turns out there is an exception, but I'm not going to tell you that until later in the course, because then you'll get confused. These enzymes just work on DNA viruses. So in the cell, we have DNA-dependent RNA polymerases. There are three classes. You probably all know this from introductory biology. Most of the viruses that we talk about use cellular enzymes to make their mRNA. There is one exception. What do you think it is? Pox virus. It brings in its own polymerase. But the polyomas, the SV40s, parvoviruses, adenoviruses, herpes viruses, even though they have big genomes, they encode proteins that are needed by the RNA polymerase. But the actual RNA polymerases are the ones that the cell provides to make mRNAs from the viruses. So as you know, the cells, eukaryotic cells, encode three RNA polymerases. They're called pol 1, 2, and 3. And they make different kinds of cellular RNAs, ribosomal RNA, messenger RNAs, tRNAs, and a bunch of others. For the viruses, we don't know any viruses that utilize pol 1. Pol 2 is used to make viral pre-mRNAs, as we'll see today, and also microRNAs. And here's the exception. There's an RNA virus that's actually copied by pol 2. So I lied to you at the beginning of this course when I said no RNA genome can be copied by a cellular enzyme. And that's true for most RNA viruses. There is one, hepatitis delta. It's a single-stranded RNA virus, which we haven't really talked about. We'll put that in a separate lecture on unusual infectious agents. It can actually be copied by pol 2. And pol 3 makes some small RNAs of adenoviruses and Epstein-Barr virus. All right. So this is the process of transcription of DNA, which, again, you should know this because this is part of introductory biology. It starts in the nucleus. The DNA, with the exception of pox viruses, is in the nucleus. There is a promoter from which transcription initiates. You get a transcript, which is capped. We'll talk a little bit about the cap structure in a moment. And then you have made what is called a pre-mRNA. It's not yet an mRNA. It has intervening sequences or introns which need to be removed by splicing. We'll talk about that today. And it has to be polyadenylated. And the polyadenylation occurs after the sequence for polyadenylation has been passed by the polymerase. So you actually have cleavage at a polyadenylation site and addition of poly A, splicing. And then that can be exported. And when it's exported, then it's an mRNA in the cytoplasm. So that's why we call these pre-mRNAs. So as far as we know, most or all cellular mRNAs get spliced before they're put out into the cytoplasm. And many viral mRNAs are also spliced, but many are not, as we'll see today. And it turns out this is important because splicing is what marks a pre-mRNA for nuclear export. So we have to talk about how viruses get around that. These mRNAs, of course, once they're in the cytoplasm, are translated into protein. And then after a certain amount of time, which depends on the mRNA, they have different half-lives, they're degraded, and you start over again. So the transcription of pre-mRNA occurs in very distinct steps, and they're outlined here. Again, this is basic cell biology, which I expect you know. I just show it to make sure we all understand what's going on. But, of course, most of my interest is telling you about what viruses do with the process. We have a DNA with a promoter sequence. The promoter is recognized, and a pre-initiation complex is formed, which is composed of the RNA polymerase and a lot of other proteins that we'll talk a little bit about. This is the primary regulation step for transcription, the formation of this pre-initiation complex. A lot of proteins involved, and their activities can be modified to influence the rate of transcription. Then we have elongation. The polymerase moves away from the promoter, and it starts to make an RNA. And this is often terminated after 20 to 30 bases. And so many events don't go very far. But the ones that do continue to elongate end up making the RNA transcript. And then the polymerase is released at the end. And so again, this is a pre-mRNA that would undergo the processing and export reactions that we talked about. Now, the control region is important when we talk about what viruses do to transcription. And this is a Pol II transcriptional control region. It can be as long as 10,000 bases. So here we have the initiator. This, the red arrow is where the transcript initiates on the double-stranded DNA template, which is shown here. And we have a series of sequences which are important for this process. There's an initiator sequence right around the transcription start site, and this specifies accurate starts. The polymerase has to start at the right place. And then there's a TATA sequence. This is a TATA containing sequence which binds a transcription protein called TF2D. And for many, this is a core promoter. You can take just these two sequences, and this will specify transcription in vitro. Without any regulation, the polymerase will attach to this core promoter and initiate transcription. But in cells and in viral genomes, it's much more complicated. You have often other sequences. They're called local regulatory sequences. They're shown here in green and brown and orange. And those are bound by transcription proteins. And these sequences, together with the core promoter, consist of the actual promoter. So this can now be regulated. And then even farther away, we can have, so this is typically 100 to 500 bases away from the promoter. The core promoter is 20 to 35 base pairs. But at 100 to 10,000 bases away, there can be distal regulatory sequences. These are called enhancers or silencers, and they do what the name would suggest. They can enhance or silence transcription. And these are typically position and orientation independent. We'll talk about how they work in a moment. So these are all things that viral genomes can have. So all of this is the transcriptional control region, and that can be quite large, as you can see. So here are just three examples of regulatory sequences in viral genomes. And I don't want you to memorize this. I just want you to see what these look like and how they differ, because there's a lot of variety, because viral genomes differ in their complexity, and they have different requirements for transcriptional regulation. So here we have the adenovirus major late promoter. So adenovirus has a number of different promoters. We're going to go from SV40 in the polyomas, which has one promoter, maybe two if you stretch it, to some viruses that have a few, and herpes viruses, which are not on here, that have many, many different promoters. So here's a diagram of the major late promoter of AD. It has an initiator sequence. That's the transcription start site, the TATA box, and a few upstream protein binding regions. SV40 early, different protein binding sequences. These are for the protein called SP1. And a TATA binding box doesn't really have an initiator sequence and has multiple initiation sites. And a different adenovirus promoter, you see, is constructed differently from the major late promoter. So basically, they all have transcription start sites. They may or may not have initiator. And they have a collection of upstream proteins that regulate transcription. So to take the movement of the polymerase in a little more detail, we again start with our DNA template, or initiator sequences in yellow. There's the transcription start site in red. The RNA polymerase is shown here. And that, together with a number of proteins, including the TATA box protein, the TATA box binding protein, and a number of others, form that initiation complex. And so those proteins help the polymerase recognize that sequence. Then the DNA has to be unwound. So the initial complex that's formed is called a closed complex because the DNA is still double-stranded. It then has to be unwound. There are unwinding activities in some of these proteins. They require ATP, so you know, it can unwind the DNA. So the polymerase can then recognize the template strand and begin copying it. There are many abortive transcripts made, as I mentioned earlier. That's because the polymerase remains in contact with initiation proteins and doesn't move away. It makes some short RNAs and for the most part doesn't move. But at some point, it undergoes what's called escape, promoter escape. Contacts between these initiation proteins and the polymerase are broken, they're severed, and the polymerase moves away and makes its nascent RNA. So this is just a model of the binding of this closed initiation complex to DNA. It's based on structural data shown on the left here. This is the TATA binding protein, and this is the TATA sequence to which it's binding. And you can see that you start with the DNA template. There's the TATA box and the initiator sequence. And the polymerase is here at the initiator. And look at all these other proteins. There's the helicase, TF2H. That's the one that's going to unwind the duplex DNA, the TATA binding protein. And these are nucleation points for lots of other proteins that bind. And the DNA gets unwound. It also seems to be bent. This seems to be important for the initiation of transcription. Here's how enhancers work. These are the control sequences that work up to 10,000 base pairs away. Here is our initiation complex again. The polymerase, TATA binding protein, and all the other initiation proteins binding at this site. Enhancers can be far away, and they're shown here in this orange sequence. And they bind specific proteins called enhancer binding proteins that also interact with the initiation complex, and they enhance the initiation by helping to position the complex on the DNA. They're not essential. For some genes, they may be essential, but they're not essential for all, but they enhance synthesis. So in some cases where you want more synthesis of a specific mRNA, there would be an enhancer upstream. All right, so let's go to Socrative. RNA call two transcriptional elements. Control elements include which of the following? That's right. It's all of the above. So they have a core promoter consisting of TATA sequences in the initiator. Local regulatory sequences, for sure. Distant enhancers, that's true in a promoter. So it's all of them. All right, let's talk about the regulation now of viral transcription. And there are a number of viral-specified proteins that either upregulate or downregulate transcription depending on the scenario. So there are virus-specific proteins, but there are also host proteins that are involved, and you saw some of them in the previous slides. Viruses can encode such proteins that regulate transcription. We'll talk about specific examples in a moment. In some cases, they actually bring these proteins in the virus particle. So much as some RNA viruses package a polymerase in the particle, some viruses package transcriptional regulatory proteins, and because their promoters are not recognized well by the cellular machinery. And herpes virus is going to be an example of this. A lot of these are called coactivating molecules, the viral proteins. So there are both transcription proteins that bind DNA, and they're coactivators. And coactivators are proteins that don't bind DNA, but they can modulate transcription by interacting with the transcription complex. And many of these coactivators modulate the structure of of nucleosomal templates. Now, you know our chromosomal DNA is wrapped up around histones to form nucleosomes. And depending on how tight the DNA is wrapped around the histone, if it's very tight, it's not very transcriptionally active. If it's loose, it can be more transcriptionally active. And the tightness of the DNA wrapping around the histone is depending on modifications like acylation and methylation. And so what we're talking about when we say the coactivators modulate, these are probably like histone deacetylases or acetylases or methylases and so forth that can modify the structure of the nucleosome. So remember, when the DNA of the virus gets into the cell, typically the cell wraps it up into nucleosomes. So for the most part, most viruses, with the exception of the polyomas, the DNA in the particle is not nucleosomed. It's not chromatinized, as they say. But all the others, adenovirus, herpes virus, it exists in a different form in the capsid. But as soon as that gets into the nucleus, it's chromatinized. It's turned into a structure that looks like this. So it's subject to the same types of regulations that would regulate nucleosomal activity. So there are also sequence-specific binding proteins. These are typically regulatory molecules that have multiple domains. Okay, so this is a diagram of a generic sequence-specific transcriptional activator. Now, this is not a coactivator because a coactivator doesn't bind DNA. These would be proteins, viral or host cell, that bind DNA and contribute to regulation of transcription. And these are typically modular. They have multiple domains. And the functions of the domains are shown here. For example, there's a DNA binding domain. There's a domain that helps the protein to make dimers. Many of these are active as dimers. And then there is an activation domain that is the part of the protein that stimulates transcription. And just below this are the different kinds of structural motifs that we know exist in each domain. For example, DNA binding domains can be zinc finger domains. They can be helix turned helix domains or basic structures. Dimers domains are typically leucine zippers, and you can see the different domains for activation. All right, so these are both cellular and viral proteins that bind to DNA and regulate transcription. They can have this kind of modular structure. So here's an example of a very well-known transcription protein called AP1, which is actually a heterodimer of two different polypeptides called Jun and Fos, and you can see them here. And here you can see they are dimerizing via this leucine zipper domain that's right up here. So the Jun and Fos subunits are forming dimers. And then there is a DNA binding domain which is interacting, you can see, in the major and minor groove of the DNA by virtue of it being a dimer. And this happens to be a basic region which is conferring DNA specificity. So just, yes?
What do you mean by basic
region? It's a series of basic amino acids, essentially. The question was, what do I mean by a basic region, series of basic amino acids? So let's look at what different types of viruses do in terms of transcription. So these are different strategies of viral DNA templates. Much like, you know, we put RNA viruses into plus and minus and double strand, what do they do when they get into a cell? This is what the DNA viruses do. So on this column, we're looking at the origin of the transcriptional components. In here, the first entry is the virus uses everything that the host provides. It doesn't encode any transcription proteins, no RNA polymerase, uses what the host provides. And these are the simple retroviruses. We haven't talked about these yet, but these are retroviruses. These are RNA viruses that are converted to DNA. And the DNA integrates into the genome. So they are transcribed by the host cell machinery entirely. Now, in contrast, there are complex retroviruses that have more proteins. That's what it means for them to be complex. And they make at least one viral protein. So they use the host to make RNA, and then they make a viral protein that orchestrates the host in some way. So for example, in this case, the viral protein regulates transcription. The complex retroviruses encode at least one protein that regulates transcription in some way, as we will see. And this class includes not only the complex retroviruses, but parvoviruses, those single-stranded DNA viruses we talked about, and the papilloma and polyoma viruses, the circular double-stranded DNA viruses. So again, they are being transcribed by the host cell RNA polymerase. All the DNA viruses are except pox, but they are encoding one viral protein that is needed to orchestrate transcription. And you'll see what I'm talking about in a moment. We don't talk much about phages in this course, but here you can see there are a couple of bacteriophages where the viral protein is actually an RNA polymerase. So some phages encode their own polymerase to transcribe late genes, and that's T3 and T7. And this is not the case for any eukaryotic viruses, as far as we know. Now, of course, this may change with these bigger viruses. They may encode their own polymerase. Then we have a situation where the host is utilized, again, for polymerase. But then there are several viral proteins that act sequentially to stimulate sets of genes. And we'll talk about examples of that in a moment. That includes adenoviruses, some phages, and also herpes viruses. And then in a separate class, all by its own, pox viruses, everything is encoded by the virus. Yes?
Oh,
so I didn't define a late gene yet, and we will do that. But a late gene is something that requires the synthesis of early viral proteins to activate the promoter. But hang on, we'll define that in a moment. Okay, let's look at some of these. First, we have to answer a question. Okay, which of the following is correct concerning proteins that regulate transcription? There you go. Number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all of the above, which is correct. So they include sequence-specific activator proteins that bind promoter elements. This is correct. They include co-activators, which do not bind DNA. This is correct also. Some viral genomes encode co-activators. This is true. Some of them also include activators, but it doesn't matter for that question. And they may have multiple protein domains. That's right. The DNA binding domain, dimerization domain, activation domain that I showed you. So all of the above is the correct answer. All right, so let's talk about some patterns of regulation of transcription. We're going to use three different viruses, same as we did for DNA replication. We're going to use a polyoma, an adenovirus, and a herpes virus to illustrate how transcription is regulated. And typically, as I've mentioned, this is done by proteins that interact with the polymerase to establish a circuit. And we're going to talk about positive loops, where the protein positively regulates transcription. And here, the transcription is increased by altering the rate, and viral proteins can do this. There are also negative autoregulatory loops, where a viral protein will repress gene transcription. There are times in the cycle when you don't need some viral proteins anymore, so you repress their synthesis and you turn on the synthesis of others. And then we'll talk about transcriptional cascades. That is, you have a series of transcriptional units. What I mean by that is simply a set of genes with a single promoter, and their transcription occurs in a fixed sequence. So we have transcription unit 1, which is fired first, and then 2, and then 3. So we'll illustrate that by pictures in a moment. I just wanted to summarize it first. So on the top is positive versus negative autoregulatory loops. So this example is a positive loop. So here we have a promoter sequence with the transcription start site in red. This is a viral DNA, for example. This viral genome comes into a cell. The promoter is recognized by cellular polymerase and cellular transcription proteins that we've talked a little bit about. And then that first gene, an mRNA, is made for gene X. And that mRNA is translated into protein X. Protein X is a protein that positively regulates this promoter. So it regulates its own promoter. That is a positive autoregulatory loop. It's positive because it's increasing transcription, and it's autoregulatory because it's increasing its own transcription, not that of another gene. All right, so as a consequence, you make more of gene X. So as soon as protein X is made, so maybe the promoter initially isn't so efficient, but as soon as protein X becomes part of the initiation complex, now you increase the rate of synthesis. So the virus is making lots and lots of these mRNAs. and that's shown over here. So this could also be negative autoregulatory. This protein could be negatively regulating itself. It wouldn't make sense to do so at the beginning of an infectious cycle, of course, but later on when you don't need this protein anymore, it could be negatively regulated. Now at the bottom is an example of cascade regulation, where we have, again, a viral DNA, and here we have two promoters. The one on the left encodes gene X. This DNA gets into a cell. Gene X is transcribed into mRNA. It's translated into protein X. Protein X is then required for the transcription of gene Y. So that is a cascade where one protein is required for the next set of genes to be transcribed. So when gene X is not made, neither is gene Y. Gene Y depends on protein X because it's part of the transcriptional initiation complex. And this can get rather complicated. There can be multiple levels of cascades. There could be several, as we will see. All right? So again, the viral genome is initially transcribed to form an mRNA encoding this transcriptional regulator that then is obligate for the synthesis of the downstream genes. That's what we mean by a cascade. That's what we mean by the transcriptional units have to be activated in a fixed sequence. Number one goes first, gene X, and then number two, and so forth. And some examples of the proteins we're going to be talking about today. Different classes. There are some autoregulatory molecules. These are proteins, viral proteins, that regulate their own synthesis. And SV40T antigen is one of them. Remember that SV40T is an origin binding protein that initiates DNA replication. Well, it's also a transcription protein. It participates in the activation of the SV40 promoter. Herpes simplex virus has another similar protein called ICP4. Names are not so important, more the concept, what they're doing is very important. Some viruses encode proteins that bind DNA. In other words, their transcriptional regulatory activity is due to the fact that they are binding DNA directly. T antigen is a directly DNA binding protein. The EBNA protein of Epstein-Barr virus, ICP4 of herpes, and E2 of adenovirus. Other transcriptional regulatory proteins of viruses bind host cell proteins. And one example of that is herpes simplex virus, VP16, which we'll talk about specifically a bit later. And then finally, others liberate host TAs. TAs are not teaching assistants. These are transcriptional activators. So the host has its own set of transcriptional activators, of course. And sometimes these are bound up in inactive complexes, and viruses replication, the virus transcription requires them. And so viral proteins liberate these. And again, these include T, E1A, and E7. These should be a little familiar because these are the same proteins that kickstart viral DNA replication. They turn the cell on into a DNA synthesis mode by bypassing the checkpoint. And we'll get back to what's going on with these in a moment. All right, so these are three viral transcriptional programs I want to talk about with you today. We have SV40, a simple one, adenovirus, and more complicated, and then even more complicated, herpes simplex type 1. So we'll take these one at a time. We're going to start with SV40. So you remember, this is a double-stranded circular DNA, not very large. It has a single origin of replication. When this DNA gets into the cell, it goes to the nucleus, where its early promoter, shown by E, is recognized by the host cell machinery, and that leads to the production of mRNA encoding the large T antigen, or T antigen that we've talked about before. So T antigen is the first protein made, and remember, you need that to start DNA replication. So the lines here mean red, of course, is inhibitory, and green is stimulatory with respect to the transcriptional protein. So large T stimulates DNA synthesis, as we saw before. It also stimulates the transcription of the late transcriptional unit. So it's a transcription protein itself. It binds to late promoters and turns them on. So without T, those don't get turned on. So the idea is that the late genes that are under the control of this late promoter, these are structural proteins that you don't need early on in infection. You don't need to be making capsid proteins until you've got genomes. So first you make large T, that turns on DNA replication, you make a lot of genomes, and then you make capsid proteins. So the way that's regulated is by having large T required for late gene expression. And also it turns out that late gene expression is repressed by a mechanism that is negated when viral DNA synthesis occurs. So as soon as the viral DNAs begin to replicate, that also, in addition to large T, turns on the late promoter, so you can make capsid proteins for encapsidation. So this is a relatively simple infectious cycle. You have one viral protein that is regulating the promoter. Now you also see there's a red bar here for LT. As soon as LT is made, it begins to dampen early promoter activity. So the products of the early transcriptional unit are the T antigens. And once those are made and get DNA replication started, you don't need as much of those any longer. So here's a diagram of the SV40 genome to show you the transcriptional map. This is really interesting because it's a pretty compact genome. It doesn't have a lot of genes, so it has to do a lot of tricks to get enough proteins out of this genome. The DNA is shown in the middle in blue, of course. Here's the origin of replication, so one origin of replication. And there is a promoter that works in both directions from that origin. The early genes are transcribed to the left, so you can see them here. They're all capped, as you can see. We'll talk about capping in a moment. So the early genes, as soon as this DNA gets into the cell, the early genes are transcribed. They encode a variety of T antigens. There's a small T, which we haven't talked about, and there's also a large T antigen as well. So again, as soon as this DNA gets in, early genes are made. Then, as soon as T is made, that activates the promoter for late genes, which are to the right here. So again, the transcription occurs to the right. And you can see these are capsid proteins. VP1, 2, and 3 are the structural components. You don't need those as soon as the DNA gets in the cell. You need them later when DNA replication has occurred. So the large T turns on the late transcript, and also DNA also turns on that late transcription unit. So you can see there's a lot of overlapping mRNAs here. So they're made and translated in different open reading frames. So you can get multiple proteins from a very compact genome. There's also some splicing events here that give rise to the different proteins. So there are two phases for this infectious cycle, and one protein regulates it. There's an early phase where T antigen is produced, and then there's a late phase, which the late proteins are made by the late transcription unit in response to T antigen. Because this is such a small genome, it doesn't have a lot of regulatory sequences. It just has this origin and promoters that go in both directions. So it has to make all the proteins it needs. It needs to do differential splicing and polyadenylation, overlapping reading frames, and so forth. And as I've said, the T antigen dampens early transcription and stimulates late transcription. All right, so that's a relatively simple transcriptional regulatory circuit. Let's move up a bit to adenovirus, which, as you know, is a bigger genome. It's double-stranded DNA. It's linear. And here we have three viral proteins in addition to DNA synthesis, which regulate the transitions from one transcriptional unit to the other. So the DNA genome gets into a cell, goes to the nucleus, and, of course, the first event is that you have to make a protein. First, you make an mRNA encoding that protein, and that is the E1A mRNA. So E stands for early, and 1A is simply a gene number. So as soon as that genome gets in, the E1A protein is needed. So that's an early protein because it's the first thing that's made as soon as the viral DNA gets in. E1A is necessary for transcription of all the early transcription units. E1A is an immediate early protein, so that's what the IE stands for. So it's, that means it's the first one that is made. Now in SV40 we didn't call them immediate early and early, it's just early and late because there's only one protein, but here it's a little more complicated. So E1A is an immediate early protein whose synthesis is necessary for all the early transcription units to be made. So here are the early transcription units, E. And the protein that is made there is called E2. So it's an early gene, but its synthesis is dependent on the presence of E1A. So again, the E1A promoter is recognized by cellular machinery. and it's transcribed into mRNA encoding E1A. But then the subsequent promoters require different viral proteins to get them to work properly. So E1A is one of those, activates the early promoter, and then you get the synthesis of E2. E2 is required for DNA replication. So DNA replication will not occur until E2 is made. So again, you want to delay synthesis of DNA until you have all the right proteins. It's also needed for entry into the late phase. So E2 activates the late promoter. So here we have a one two-way cascade, I suppose. You have E1A activating early, E2 activates late. And then finally, the late genes include another transcription protein called 4A2, which stimulates late gene transcription, and it also binds a late protein that enhances that. So with late gene synthesis, these include the structural proteins that you need to make a new capsid, of course. By this time, DNA replication is occurring because E2 has stimulated DNA replication. There's also relief of late promoter inhibition by DNA replication, which is what I mean that DNA synthesis governs late phase transitions. It's the same for SV40, where DNA replication relieved oppression of the late promoter. So this is a common theme. Late promoters typically encode structural proteins. You want those shut off until you have substantial DNA replication occurring, because there's no point in making them until you have DNAs to put in the virions. All right, so a little more complicated cascade, but again, the key point here is you have a series of proteins made that sequentially activate transcriptional units, but the first one made for both SV40 and adenovirus is transcribed by the cell. That promoter is recognized by the cell. In the case of SV40, it's T antigen. In the case of adeno, it's the E1A promoter. They're recognized by the cell, and that gets the viral program going. And then the virus can adjust what it needs on its own because it's now making transcriptional regulatory proteins. Yeah?
When it's sequential positive enhanced promotion,
right?
Is it safe to say that the ultimate amount of product is being amplified by the fact that, you know, for every five products the person mm-hmm. makes,
right,
each one of those is making five products, each one of those
right
is making.
So the question is, when you have these sequential transcription units, do you get amplification? And yeah, the answer is yes, because you make more E1A, you get more E2, and then so forth down the line. Now here there's no repression going on, but for SV40, LT eventually is repressing its own synthesis because you've got enough to do the task. So let's take a look at the adenovirus genome. This is more complicated than SV40. There are 8 polymerase II transcription units. So in SV40 there were 2, the early and the late. In adenovirus, which has a double-stranded DNA genome, there are 8 transcription units, which are expressed in the 4 phases that I just told you. All right, and let's see if we can find some of these. Here's the early transcription unit, the E1A protein, which it needs to be made before anything else can happen. If you don't make E1A, or if you make a virus deleted for E1A, it's dead. Nothing will happen. You cannot replicate that virus. So E1A is essential for everything else to happen. The E2 transcription unit is here. It's on the other strand going in the other direction. So this virus makes transcripts from both DNA strands. You can see on the top and on the bottom strand. So that's the E2 transcription unit. The 4A2 late gene is shown here. And then there are other late genes here. In fact, there's a major late transcription unit, which is shown here, ML. It starts near the one end, the left end of the genome, and goes all the way to one end and encodes many different proteins. These are late proteins, structural proteins, that are encoded by this late major late transcript. And this is synthesized as a long pre-mRNA that's spliced to form mRNAs encoding all of those individual proteins. All right, so early, again, E1A is made, stimulates E2 proteins, which stimulates the late gene products. Now, how does E1A work? So E1A is needed for the activation of the E2 promoter. Let's look at how this works. Here's what E1A looks like. It's this blue molecule, which is forming a zinc finger. That is a structure where the protein forms a finger, which is coordinated by a zinc binding to four cysteines here. E1A binds cellular transcription proteins, and here are a couple of them here. And this helps assemble the closed pre-initiation complex. So otherwise, the E2 promoter wouldn't be readily recognized by cellular RNA Pol II and all the transcription proteins associated with it. But when E1A is made, by virtue of the fact that it's binding a number of transcription proteins, it stimulates the assembly of this complex. So it's promoting the cell to recognize the E2 promoter, right? And that's how E1A is working. Now, in addition, E1A has another activity. This E2 promoter, which is being stimulated here in the top by E1A, the E2 promoter binds a series of transcription proteins. These are cellular transcription proteins called E2Fs. So these are cellular transcription proteins that were discovered by studying adenovirus replication, because it turns out that the E2 promoter requires these proteins, and then people found that they're actually proteins needed by the cell. In fact, you may remember that the proteins the cell needs to replicate its genome and go through the cell cycle also require E2F transcription proteins. This is going to come back a couple more times in this course. So normally in the cell, E2F is complex with another protein called DP1, but it's all bound up by the RB protein, the retinoblastoma protein. So this transcription protein is inactive. It will bind the E2F sites on DNA, but transcription will not occur because it's repressive. The presence of the RB protein, which is in, what's this color, green? I don't even know what it is. It represses the transcription. So this is an E2F site. This could be the viral E2 site, or it could be a cellular E2 site. The point is, when the virus comes in a cell, it makes E1A, and E1A wants to turn on E2 synthesis. The E2 promoters are bound with RB linked to the E2F complex. So the other thing that E1A does, it bumps off RB from this complex. All right, because the virus requires active E2F proteins in order to get transcriptions from the E2 early promoter. So this is a second function of E1A. Last time, we talked about how E1A removes RB from these E2F proteins, and that makes the cell make DNA synthesis proteins, and it pushes it through the cell cycle. Now we see the virus is doing it also because it needs its own E2 promoters activated. I don't know which came first. It's an interesting question, because it's kind of interesting that you have a cellular E2F requirement and a viral requirement, and I don't know how that would evolve, which one would come first. Anyway, the point is that E1A has two ways of stimulating E2 promoter activity. It stimulates DNA synthesis, and then we'll see in a bit later in this course how E1A can also cause cellular transformation leading to oncogenesis, to cancer. All right, now herpes virus is the last transcriptional protein we're going to look at. This is more complicated. Here, the viral DNA is not recognized by the cellular transcriptional unit. It's by the cellular Pol II. So when that DNA gets, if you put naked herpes viral DNA into the cell, it's not readily recognized by Pol II. So the virus brings into the cell a protein called VP16. So here's a diagram of the herpes virion. In the middle is an icosahedral capsid with the DNA genome in it. And then there's an envelope around it with glycoproteins. And you can see all this stuff in the middle. These are a variety of viral proteins. One of those is VP16. So what happens is that that protein is liberated as the virus infects the cell. We'll see how that happens in a moment. And that protein is required for immediate early transcription. So just like adenovirus had an immediate early gene, E1A, herpes has immediate early genes. But these aren't made by the cell alone. They require this VP16 protein to participate in transcription. We'll see how that happens in a moment. You then have immediate early proteins made after immediate early transcription. These include ICP4 and ICP0, and these control transcription from subsequent genes. The immediate early genes turn on the transcription of the early genes. They also turn on DNA synthesis, as you can see here, expression of early genes and DNA synthesis. And then finally, they also turn on the synthesis of late genes. So single proteins made from the immediate early region turn on both early and late gene synthesis. Among the early proteins are replication proteins, which bind the origin. You remember that herpes viruses encode most of the proteins needed for DNA replication, so those would be some of the early proteins. And then once DNA synthesis occurs, the DNA synthesis, by the way, in all these slides is diagrammed by this purple bar, as you can see here. As soon as DNA synthesis occurs, you have late gene expression, which includes structural proteins. So the whole idea here is to make the proteins when you need them. That's why you have this complicated series of events. VP16 activates the immediate early genes. They activate early genes, which include replication proteins, and late genes, which include structural proteins. All right? So this is more complicated because the genome is bigger, has more genes, and this virus does not do any splicing. So both SV40 and adenovirus did a lot of alternative splicing. So they could get lots of proteins from smaller DNA genome. But herpes does not splice most of its mRNAs for reasons that we don't understand. So it has to have more transcriptional units to make more proteins as a consequence. So things get very complicated. So how does VP16 work? It works in at least two ways. Again, this is the virus protein that's brought in with the virion. It's needed to turn on the immediate early gene transcription unit. VP16 is thought to bind one of the transcription proteins called TF2B, which is essential for the formation of the complex. So normally TF2B is in a closed formation, as you can see here, and it can participate in initiation complex formation, but when VP16 is present, it is opened up and more efficiently helps to assemble pre-initiation complexes. And there are specific binding sites for part of VP16 on viral on the immediate early viral promoter, so that effectively recruits the cellular transcription machinery to that immediate early transcription unit. So that's one way, by opening up TF2B and recruiting it to the complex. It's also believed that VP16 participates in loosening up the chromatin. Now, this is what I was talking about earlier. So when herpes DNA gets in the cell, in the virion, it's not chromatinized. It's not bound up with histones. But as soon as it gets in the nucleus, it's chromatinized and wrapped up like this. And the default is to shut off gene expression, to wrap the DNA very tightly around histones. And here is the E1A promoter, for example. It has a binding site for VP16, and VP16 is thought to bind this and recruit proteins like histone deacetylases that can loosen up the chromatin. All right, so this ensures that the E1A transcriptional unit would be active, because again, the default is for it to be shut off. The cell sees the DNA come in, there's no reason for it to be turned on, so it wraps the DNA tightly around histones, but VP16 can get around that. That's pretty neat protein. All right, so this is the scary herpes virus life cycle, which I haven't shown you before. I wanted to, yes?
So before we move on to VP16, did you say that the cellular POL2 can't recognize the viral DNA?
So cellular POL2 does not recognize the immediate early transcription unit of herpes. It needs VP16 to be present there.
Okay. So I was just wondering how VP16 made it recognize it, but it's just through the...
So this is how it does it. It helps to recruit TF2B to the complex, which is normally... And it also opens up the chromatin, which occurs when the viral DNA gets in the nucleus. Okay. That's how VP16 works. Yes?
What's a DL
gene? I'm sorry. DL is a delayed late. So there are two classes of herpes late genes. There's late and delayed late. And they're all turned on at the same time. So let's just go through this in terms of the life cycle. The virus is binding to receptors. It fuses at the cell surface. And the nucleocapsid binds microtubules and gets put in put on the nuclear pore. The DNA goes in the nucleus, circularizes, and replicates as a rolling circle. In the meantime, VP16 is in the space between the membrane and the capsid. That gets into the cytoplasm. It has a nuclear localization signal, so it goes into the nucleus, can activate the immediate early transcription unit on the viral DNA. That makes this mRNA encoding for the immediate early proteins, ICP0 and ICP4. Those proteins go into the nucleus and turn on the synthesis of early proteins, and those are shown here. The mRNAs are made, they go out in the cytoplasm, and then they are translated into the proteins. And finally, those proteins, those early proteins, go in the nucleus. They stimulate DNA replication. That's one of their functions. And they also turn on late gene transcriptional units. There's an mRNA encoding a late gene. And those encode the structural proteins. So those go back in the nucleus. They build capsids containing new DNA, which then comes out of the cell. So a really nicely orchestrated series of events, all starting with this VP16 protein. Again, the key is to make sure you make things when you need them. Herpes has something like 80 different genes, many different transcription units, so it needs to be able to regulate them. All right, so adeno-E1A stimulating the expression of adeno-E2 protein, which then stimulates the expression of adeno-4A2 and L4, is an example of number 3, a couple of the others, but you mostly got it. A cascade regulation, of course. It's not a negative autoregulatory loop. It is not repression. It's not dimerization. It's cascade regulation. All right, let's just look briefly at capping and polyadenylation, because there's not much virus specificity about this process. This is a cap, which is put on the 5' end of mRNAs. Normally, the bases in mRNA are linked in a 5 to 3' direction. By the 3' oxygen here to the 5' carbon. But the cap is put on in a 5 to 5' linkage. It protects the 5' end of the RNA. It has lots of other functions, as we'll see when we talk about translation. And it's typically methylated here, and there can be methylations of the next two bases as well. And those are important for the function of the cap. In the cell, the cap is put on by cellular capping enzymes. And you don't need to know the pathway at all. I just want to show you how viruses can do it differently. So they would start with the 5' end of RNA as it's made by Pol II. It has a triphosphate. The cell removes one of the phosphates, then adds a G by guanylyl transferase. It puts the G on in the 5 to 5' linkage, and then methylated at the cap and also at different residues as well. So this is a methyl transferase. All these enzymes are cellular enzymes. Viruses, many viruses encode their own capping machinery. SV40 and the polyomas do not, but the larger viruses do. Here's an example of an RNA virus and how it caps. It actually does it differently because it methylates the G first before adding it to the RNA. So it does take off a phosphate by a triphosphatase, just like the cellular enzyme, but it adds a methylated G rather than methylating it later. Capping occurs co-transcriptionally. Here's a DNA with a transcription initiation site. An RNA polymerase has begun to make RNA here. And when this RNA is about 20 to 30 bases long, the polymerase is phosphorylated by one of the proteins associated with it. The phosphorylation signals the capping enzyme to come in and bind the transcribing complex, and that puts a cap on. So the cap is only added until there are 20 to 30 bases on the nascent RNA, and this is probably because so many transcriptional events are abortive, you don't want to put a cap on a transcript that's not going to make it. Polyadenylation at the other end is also a well-known cellular process. Much of it worked out here at Columbia, in fact. You have a pre-mRNA made. There is a poly-A addition site, which is well before the 3' end of the pre-mRNA. The poly-A addition site signals the nucleation of a number of cellular proteins, which end up cleaving the pre-mRNA, getting rid of this 3' end. And then poly-A is added to the 3' end by poly-A polymerase. All right, so it's kind of unusual because the RNA polymerase doesn't know anything about polyadenylation. It just goes past the poly-A addition site, and then other enzymes come in to cleave and polyadenylate. So this is very different from RNA viruses, of course, which add poly-U either by having it in poly-A, either by having it encoding in the template as a series of U, or by stuttering at a few U's. And that's shown here. So the mechanisms of adding poly-A we talked about in viral genomes, reiterative copying, or copying of a 5' terminal U stretch in the template, whereas in cellular genes, it's cleavage of pre-mRNA, as I've just told you. Vaccinia does it completely differently. All right, so the next question, which statement about polyadenylation of DNA virus mRNAs is correct? Wow, a little confusion here. Okay, so we've got 2 and 4. What's going on here? So it doesn't occur in the cytoplasm. It occurs in the nucleus. It occurs before the mRNAs are shipped out of the nucleus. It occurs after cleavage of pre-mRNA. So you make a pre-mRNA, then you cleave at the polyadenylation site, as we showed in this slide. So you make a long precursor, and then you cleave it at the poly-A addition site, and then you add poly-A. That was the other one. Poly-A is added at the 5' end. No, you don't add it at the 5' end. It's at the 3' end. The cap is added at the 5' end. And it's specified by a stretch of U's in the template. That's correct for RNA viruses, but this question is asking about DNA viruses. All right, the last thing I want to talk about is splicing of pre-mRNAs.
What is perhaps the most amazing aspect of transcription, the fact that mRNAs are bigger than they actually end up being for the most part. mRNA splicing was discovered in cells infected with adenovirus. And there are two pieces of data that led to this conclusion initially, and the first is shown in part A on this figure. Now, late in adenovirus-infected cells, a variety of late messenger mRNAs are produced. And when these were analyzed chemically, it was found that all of the late mRNAs, and there are quite a few of them, are capped, of course, but they all have the same 5' end sequence. And that is shown here. They have the cap, and then they have A and C, which is methylated, and then this UCCCCUUUG sequence. So that was thought to be odd because it's weird that many different mRNAs would have the same sequence. And then another experiment was done which really clarified all this, and the result is shown on the bottom. This is actually a tracing of an electron micrograph, which was taken of an experimental result which involved the hybridization of DNA to RNA. So the blue is a piece of adenovirus DNA from the right hand of the genome that encodes a structural protein called the hexon. And the green is adenovirus, one of the adenovirus late mRNAs encoding the hexon. And you can see at the left, starting at the left here, the DNA is free. It's not hybridizing to anything. And then it becomes hybridized to the hexon mRNA. Now remember, what we're doing here is we're taking single-stranded DNA of the viral genome. We've denatured the double-stranded DNA. We're hybridizing it to single-stranded mRNA. So we have a little region of hybridization, and then there's a loop. The DNA forms a loop. This is labeled loop A. Then there's a second region where the mRNA hybridizes to the DNA, and then there's another loop called B. And then there's a third region of hybridization and an even bigger loop called C. And then finally, the rest of the mRNA hybridizes perfectly with the viral DNA. So what was clear from this experiment was that the mRNA of hexon is not a complete copy of the viral DNA. In fact, the mRNA is made from pieces of the initial transcript that are then joined together. So if you look at the adenoviral genome on the bottom here, the 5' blue part is not hybridizing to the hexon mRNA. The black portions that do hybridize, 1, 2, and 3, represent these three areas here. And the loops are regions of blue or orange or red that are not present in the mRNA, and therefore they loop out. And finally, the rest of the mRNA, the main part, is at the right here in green, which is present in both the DNA and in the mRNA. So something is present in the DNA, blue, orange, red, which is not present in the mRNA. What ends up being figured out here is that the mRNA is actually made as a pre-mRNA, which would represent all of the sequence, and then parts of it are removed by a process that was called splicing. And the leader that was common to all of these messages was made up of three parts of this pre-mRNA that were joined together, and that's called the tripartite leader sequence. Now, over the years, splicing was found, of course, in all cellular mRNAs, or most cellular mRNAs, and many viral mRNAs as well. And as those mRNAs were sequenced and the pre-mRNAs were sequenced, some mechanistic insight was gained. So here is how splicing of pre-mRNA works. Again, we call it pre-mRNA because it contains extra sequence that are not present in mRNA. So here's the sequence of the region of pre-mRNA at the 5' splice site, at the 3' splice site, and at what we call the branch point sequence. This pink is called an intron. It's an intervening sequence that's going to be removed by splicing from the mRNA. The green is what ends up in the mRNA, and those are called exon sequences. So this is exon 1, this is intron 1, and this is exon 2. Eventually, this will be removed, and exon 1 and 2 will be joined. How this happens is illustrated by these bases shown here. This is the frequency of occurrence of a particular base at these particular spots in the sequence. So here's the 5' splice site. The base right to the left of it is 80% of the time a G. To the right of it, 100% of the time is a G. And then here in the middle of what we call the branch point is a 100% conserved A. And then at the 3' splice site, you see conserved residues as well. The way splicing works is, starting on the lower left here, the A, the conserved, 100% conserved A, the 2' hydroxyl of that, initiates a nucleophilic attack on the phosphodiester bond right at the edge of the 5' splice site. So joining this G with the upstream G here. That breaks the bond, and you get a transesterification of that phosphodiester bond with the A. And then the next thing that happens is the 3' hydroxyl, which has now been formed by that first reaction, attacks nucleophilically again the phosphodiester bond at the 3' splice site. The two exons are joined by a phosphodiester bond, and what's remaining is an excised lariat intron. So this is the intron itself. It's been cut out by these two transesterifications, and it's actually a lariat. You know what a lariat looks like, right? That rope thing that cowboys use. There's a handle here, and then you have a loop. And this is eventually degraded and thrown away, recycled. So that's how splicing works. Splicing occurs in the cell on a very complicated structure called a spliceosome. This happens in the nucleus. A spliceosome is composed of the RNA that's going to be spliced, which is shown here on the bottom left as a pre-mRNA. It's composed of small nuclear RMPs. These are short RNAs, 100 or 200 nucleotides long, complex with proteins, and it also contains other non-SN RNP proteins as well. The spliceosome, which is composed of a number of different SN RNPs and other proteins, basically holds the pre-mRNA in a position so those transesterification reactions can take place. So you can see here there are very specific base pairings between these small RNAs of the spliceosome and the conserved sequences at the 5 and 3' splice sites and also at the lariat junction point in the middle of the intron. And you can see the first transesterification reaction occurring here, that A is attacking the 5' splice site, breaks the bond, then the 3' hydroxyl at the 5' splice site attacks the 3' splice site, the acceptor site, and then you get a mature mRNA. So this is a reaction going from pre-mRNA to mRNA, the processing reaction carried out on this very large component in the cell nucleus called the spliceosome. And the spliceosome is actually a ribozyme. It's an RNA enzyme. These reactions seem to be carried out mainly by the RNA components. The proteins are probably present just as a scaffold. So splicing gives value to your genes. As we'll see, alternative splicing creates new kinds of genes or new proteins from the genes. You can expand the coding information from a small DNA genome because you can take one gene and splice the mRNA in different ways to make multiple proteins. You can also regulate gene expression by splicing. So we'll see how this works. Here's an example of a way to get multiple proteins by splicing from a single gene. Now on the left is what's called constitutive splicing. Here we have an mRNA with two introns. They're removed all the time to give the same protein with exons 1, 2, and 3. So there's nothing unusual here. You get the same protein all the time. However, if you do alternative splicing, you can get different proteins from the same gene. So here, if you skip exons, you can get two different proteins. So here on the left is our constitutively spliced mRNA that gives us one protein. But if you skip exon 2 and just splice from 1 to 3, now you get a different protein altogether. So that's called exon skipping. You can use alternative 5' splice sites if they're present. Here is one, here's a second, and the use of either of those in conjunction with the 3' splice sites gives you two different proteins here on the bottom. Or you can have alternative 3' splice sites. Two of them here working together with the 5' splice site can give two different proteins. So alternative splicing gives you value added because you can make more proteins from a single gene. Here's an example of how alternative polyadenylation and splicing together can be regulated and can lead to very cell type specific expression. This is the genome of bovine papillomavirus, which is a double-stranded circular DNA. It's shown here as a linear molecule for simplicity. Papillomaviruses, of course, cause warts. And what we're going to focus on are two mRNAs that are differ by splicing and polyadenylation. And here is one early mRNA, and on the bottom is a late mRNA, the L1 mRNA. And these two are produced by alternative splicing. The top mRNA is produced by the use of the same 5' donor with a 3' acceptor at 3225. But the late mRNA is produced by the same 5' donor with a 3' acceptor at 3605. In addition, we have different polyadenylation sites used. We have one for the early message, a polyadenylation site here at 4203, and for a late message, a polyadenylation site at 7175. Now, the late mRNA is specifically produced in a certain type of cell called a granular cell in a wart. So on the right, upper right here are two sections of a wart caused by bovine papillomavirus, which were hybridized to show where specific mRNAs are produced. Now, here on the left, we are looking at the production of the 3225 early mRNA. And you can see that this is produced in multiple cell layers. On the right, we're looking specifically at the late L1 mRNA, which is produced by splicing at the 3605 position. And you can see that this late mRNA is only made in one cell layer, the granular cell layer. So somehow, the cell is allowing production of this other mRNA by alternative splicing. Now, how does that work? So that's shown at the bottom. So splicing is regulated by the availability, of course, of splice sites, but also of binding sites between the splice sites for cellular proteins that regulate splicing. So here are the two splice sites that are used for either the early mRNA or the late mRNA, 3225 versus 3605. In the middle, in between the two splice sites, are sequences called splicing enhancers. And they are bound by cellular proteins that regulate splicing. So, for example, binding of proteins at these two, at the SE1 site, enhances splicing at 3225, whereas binding of proteins at the ESS1 site, and ESS1 stands for exonic splicing suppressor, inhibits splicing at this site. In the same way, binding at SE2 stimulates splicing here. Now, for the other splice site, there are regulators of it as well. So, for example, binding of protein at ESS2 inhibits the splicing at the 3605 site, whereas binding of YB1 at the SE4 site stimulates splicing here. So you can see that the right balance of stimulatory and inhibitory proteins will give you either splicing at 3225 or splicing at 3605. So let's put all of this information together and see what's going on. The 3225 early mRNA is made in both the granular cell layer and lower layers. So that means that these cells must all contain proteins that allow splicing at the 3225 3' splice site. So in other words, proteins that bind SE1 and SE2 must be present in both cell layers. In contrast, the 3605 mRNA, shown down here, is only produced in the granular cell layer. So that means that in those cells, again, there must be proteins that allow splicing at the 3605 3' splice site, such as YB1, but that suppress splicing at the 3225 site, such as proteins binding to ESS1. In the lower cell layers, the proteins that allow splicing at 3605 are absent. Furthermore, there are two different polyadenylation sites used, and so that is also an element of control here. In particular, the 7175 poly-A site must be suppressed in these lower cell layers because they don't make that mRNA. And the way that's thought to occur is by binding of a U1 snRNP to a pseudo 5' splice site near the AL polyadenylation site at 7175. That binding is thought to inhibit poly-A polymerase. So this is just one example of how the proteins required for splicing can regulate splicing in a cell type specific manner. During retrovirus infection of cells, splicing is also regulated in an interesting way. Now, retroviruses are RNA viruses that have that synthesize a DNA copy of their genome, which is then integrated into the host cell. And the cell then makes mRNAs for the virus by transcription. And one of the viral mRNAs produced is a pre-mRNA shown up here, which is unspliced. Its translation leads to the production of the GAG and the polyviral proteins. But the virus also needs to make a third protein called envelope, which is encoded down here. And to get at that coding region, the GAG and the pol regions have to be removed by splicing. So the unspliced mRNA gives you GAG and pol proteins. The spliced mRNA gives you the envelope protein. If you mess with the ratio of these two mRNAs in infected cells, you interfere with viral replication. So normally, the ratio of unspliced to spliced mRNA is 2:1 in virus, wild-type virus. If you mutate the spliced donors and acceptors so that unspliced and spliced are made at equal ratios, you reduce the amount of virus that is produced. And if you further alter the sequences to favor the production of spliced RNA by 2:1, you now have no virus produced. So this very specific ratio is really important for viral propagation. But how does the virus do this? Here is how it's done on the bottom here. Here's the 5' splice site, which is shown. So that would be right here, the 5' splice site, and the 3' splice site would be here. There is, downstream of this 5' splice site, what's called an NRS, a negative regulatory sequence. It is basically another decoy 5' splice site, much like the one that we saw in the bovine papillomavirus genome. It attracts snRNPs and other components of the spliceosome. SR proteins are other non-snRNP type proteins that are in the spliceosome. But since it's a decoy, it's not actually going to be used as a splice site. But what the binding of these proteins do is to inhibit splicing right here. So a certain fraction of the time, these proteins inhibit splicing so that you get an unspliced messenger RNA produced. So that's a cool way that splicing can be regulated to make the right ratio of unspliced to spliced mRNA. Let's look at how the adenovirus regulates its splicing. The adenovirus genome, of course, is a double-stranded DNA shown at the top. It makes a variety of early and late mRNAs. And here is an example of the late RNA, the late pre-mRNA. It's a very, very long RNA that covers a good deal of the genome. It is eventually processed and alternatively spliced and polyadenylated to make at least 15 different mRNAs. And you can see there are polyadenylation sites L1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. The introns are shown in pink. So first of all, polyadenylation can occur at any of these sites, and then you can get alternative splicing to give you different kinds of mRNAs. And just a few of them are shown here on the bottom, two different L1 mRNAs. That is, mRNAs polyadenylated at the L1 site, and four different L3 mRNAs, that is, mRNAs polyadenylated at the L3 site. And these are, again, produced by alternative splicing, depending on the combinations of 5' and 3' splice sites or 3' alternative 3' splice sites that are used to give the different mRNAs. So a good example of how alternative polyadenylation and splicing can give you value added. You can have a lot of different proteins made from a single gene. In the case of adenovirus, we know very well how viral proteins can regulate alternative splicing. And this is an example. This is the L1. This is a late messenger RNA that encodes one of two proteins. So here is the unspliced mRNA, the primary transcript. Now, early in the phase of infection, these are called late mRNAs, but some they are actually produced early at lower rates. Early, this primary transcript is spliced to produce an mRNA that encodes a 52 to 55 kilodalton protein. The early mRNA processing pattern is favored because a spliceosome protein, shown here as SR, can inhibit one of the 3' splice sites, favoring the use of the other to give the L1 mRNA. And this SR protein is active when it's phosphorylated. Late in infection, one of the viral proteins, E4OR4, dephosphorylates the SR protein, so it can no longer work to inhibit splicing here. So that acts as a splicing acceptor, if you will, together with another viral protein that's needed for that to occur. And that gives you the fully spliced 3A mRNA. So an example of how a viral protein regulates splicing by modifying a cellular component of the spliceosome. An important concept to remember as we talk about splicing is that all of this happens in the nucleus, and then the spliced mRNAs have to get out of the nucleus into the cytoplasm in order for them to be translated. And that export occurs through the nuclear pore, and it occurs by a machinery, an export machinery, that recognizes the spliced mRNAs as marked for export. So let me explain what I mean by that. Here at the top, we have a primary transcript. It's unspliced. It has an intron. It is then bound by a variety of spliceosome proteins, such as this one here, UAP56, and then subsequently other proteins come in The splicing occurs, and then this mRNA that has been spliced is now marked for export because it has these spliceosome proteins bound to it. Those spliceosome proteins attract components of the nuclear export machinery, such as TAP and NXT1. So these are present to get things out of the nucleus. They recognize that this mRNA has to go out because it has this ref-ali protein bound to it as a remnant of splicing, and it can get out of the nucleus. The problem is that many viral mRNAs have to get out without being spliced. And one example is the HIV mRNAs, many of which have to be exported without being spliced. So how does that work? If you're not marked for export by being spliced, how does an unspliced message get out of the nucleus? Well, here's how it works for HIV. Here's a diagram of the HIV DNA genome integrated in the cell nucleus. Transcription by the host cell produces a long mRNA, which is subsequently spliced constitutively to produce a short mRNA encoding a single protein called Rev. Rev is then shipped back into the nucleus, where it binds the unspliced primary transcripts at the 3' end in a sequence called the Rev responsive element, RRE. So Rev binds that, and Rev allows unspliced mRNAs to get out of the nucleus into the cytoplasm. So here, for example, is an unspliced version of one of the mRNAs getting out. So you no longer require splicing to mark these mRNAs for export. As long as they have Rev bound to them, they will be exported. So Rev marks these mRNAs for export, even though they have not been spliced. It's really a brilliant way to get around the requirement of splicing for export. And many viruses have different solutions to this for getting out unspliced messages. Cellular pre-mRNAs, we said, get out of the nucleus by being marked for export by the splicing machinery. Simple retroviruses, in contrast to HIV, have another way to export unspliced messages. For HIV, which has a complex genome, the Rev response element marks unspliced mRNAs for export. Retroviruses with simple genomes don't have these proteins like Rev, and so they use a different strategy. And what they do is they have at the 3' end of their mRNA a CTE element, or constitutive transport element. So here we have an unspliced retroviral RNA. This wants to be exported without splicing. How does it do it? Well, the CTE binds the export component of the export machinery, like TAP and NXT1, which normally mark spliced mRNAs for export. They bind the CTE and allow unspliced retroviral mRNA to be exported from the nucleus.